Joke, man. I cannot believe.
Oh, God. Oh,
give me a break.
This is the smallest basement I have ever seen in my
this
life.
Building is like 200 square feet or more because I can't figure out things, and this is the basement.
Look at this. These construction guys need to...
Oh, this is supposed to be a jacuzzi. We asked for Hugh Hefner. Look what we get.
There's a divider in it. Stretch out with babes in that.
And boxes.
Oh, Jesus. Some cool stuff up here, though.
Yeah.
Nice chair.
Yeah, I guess so.
I like this chair.
Look, it's Pee-wee and Godzilla and Tori.
I'm telling you now, this is my chair.
No, I think it's my chair, because I'm going to sit there. If we have to be in a set like this, I'm sitting next to Linnea Quigley.
No, I'm sorry. This is my chair.
No, it's my chair. Dude.
It's my chair! Cheez Flikz. I'm Scott.
He's Greg.
As you know, on Cheez Flikz, we cover the strange, the unusual, and Hooters.
And, this week we're in our set. As you saw, if you were watching before the credits, I don't know, they stuck us in the damn basement.
Yeah, at least they gave us some cool stuff, though.
Yeah, well, anyway, let's get down to the first movie.
Well, before we get to that first movie, though, I just want to warn everybody out there about something, because it's a real horror story. And I think people do need to be warned about this. CBS is bringing back the Brady Bunch.
The Brady Bunch?
Oh my God. I guess I should have told you about that before. Yeah, and it's going to be like an hour long.
Oh man.
But they couldn't get the girl who played the oldest one, Marsha. They couldn't get her, so they had to get some other bimbo.
Oh, is she like a porn star?
I don't know. We'll find out. But anyway, it's CBS, and I'd avoid it because, you know, the problems in that were so topical. I mean, you know, those kids didn't have drug problems. They had, like, Cindy lost her mom's earrings. And I think that's about all we need to say is it's the Brady Bunch and it's a horror story. And anyway, speaking of horror stories, we've got our first movie.
That's Dr. Minx, starring E. Williams and Big Bill Smith. And I think Craig's going to set that one up because he's a little more offended by it than I was.
Well, I think you fell asleep through it, too.
Man, I came close.
Well, Scott mentioned Dr. Meek stars Edie Williams, and she just happens to be the ex-wife of Hooter King Russ Meyer. That's probably one of the best things you can say about this film.
You know, you might mention that it did have a really hip theme song.
Yeah, it was kind of cool. One of those kind of Latino 70s disco kind of moody kind of songs. Film starts out with Big Bill Smith, who later went on to do such films as Red Dawn and Red Dawn.
And Conan and all that kind of stuff. Of course, he was in all the biker movies. No, he's a hip dude.
Anyway, the main thing I want to say about this film is the box lies. If you pick up this box at your local video outlet, it says something about Dr. Meek seduces all of her patients, and, well, I just want to say that does not happen.
Her bedside manner will make your temperature rise, isn't that what it said?
Something like that.
Yeah, boy.
It's a lie. I'm going to say, we get to see her Hooters initially when she's with Big Bill Smith, and at the end, toward the end, we get to see her Hooters again. But the rest of the time, she wears these low-cut blouses and no Hooters, and it just goes on and on and on and on and on, and quite frankly, we'll tell the truth here. We fast-forwarded through parts of it, and I think we should just hit those clips. Like I said, she's a doctor. Her name's Dr. Meek. She's supposed to seduce people, and her husband's dead, and she has a ton of dough, and Big Bill is trying to get the dough out of her. Hit those clips.
Let me tell you something. You got plenty of dough. Let's not even talk about the money you're going to get from the insurance company. You know what you should do? You should pay me off, give me my share, because I earned it.
And she sees this bike wreck.
The doctor! Don't move! I'm okay. I'm worried about him. I don't know what happened. The bike... I was showing him how fast the bike would go. And all of a sudden, I guess the gravel made a skid. Is he gonna be all right or what?
God, I don't know. Help me move him to the car.
Okay. Get back in front and talk. Come on. You're gonna be
think this is the way most doctors handle victims of motorcycle accidents.
Look at the scene.
He's gonna be okay, isn't he?
I don't know.
I think he's in a coma. He's unconscious anyway. Like dead
weight. It's my fault. And I'm very sorry.
Sorry? You're sorry.
You gotta check these people out. They're like the ugliest people in America. All I can figure is they must be Trekkies.
Your damn carelessness? And you wanna be a policeman. You wanna go to the police academy. Don't you know now you've got a record that makes you a criminal?
Oh, my poor baby. Is he all right? Is he going to be all right?
Where's the doctor? What kind of a hospital is this? I want to know how my son is.
I'm the doctor.
You?
Yes, me.
You don't look very much like a doctor.
I'm sorry. I didn't realize doctors are supposed to look any certain way.
I talked to your mother and father this morning. They want you to come home. But I want you to stop by the hospital tomorrow for an injection. Or you could just stop by my house tonight if you'd like, since you live so close by.
Oh, I'd never come to your house tonight, I mean, if that's okay.
Boy, have you got an imagination.
Oh, yeah? You think so? Then I'll tell you what. Why don't you just ask her about her husband? I dare you. You won't because you're scared. Well, I don't blame you. The only reason she got away with it is because the sheriff in this stupid town, he isn't used to solving murders. But I'm a criminologist.
Yeah, I think this guy read detective comics as a child.
I'm zeroing in on her now. You understand? Now, I'm telling you about it, Brian. I'm warning you for old time's sake before I...
You bastard. You killed my husband. You knew the brakes were out on that bulldozer. You purposely let it run over him.
Get it off you, Donna. I made it look like it was an on-the-job.
Is she looking at her cue cards or what?
So you could get twice as much money. Now old Gus wants his half.
And in this scene here, Edie and the ugly guy that she hangs out with have killed Big Bill Smith, and the sheriff comes looking. And the sheriff is played by Alvy Moore, who played Mr. Kimball in Green Acres. And he must be a real good actor to be able to look Edie in the face.
But he said there were two people in the car.
Oh, I had another friend with me.
See? Well, probably just a couple of kids trying to rob the place, and you rang a doorbell, scared them off, and then the cleaning man. Well, I think I better check up on it on my way back. And listen, if you see Gus before I do, have him give me a call.
Token shower scene.
Will ya?
Why don't you just stop following us around, you punk, or I'll turn you into the sheriff. You've been invading my privacy, and I don't have to put up with it.
Don't talk to me like that, lady. I can prove that you killed Gus.
Who does this guy think he is, young Columbo?
Don't lie to me. Don't lie to me. Now, I saw you buried.
Good stuff. You know, there's just no way I can recommend this movie because, for one thing, Edie Williams doesn't get naked enough. I mean, there were those occasions, but it's just not
worth
the buck or so you pay for that kind of hooterage. And Big Bill, it completely goes to waste in it, so I can't even recommend it for William Smith completist, because for one thing, he's gunned down by an ugly geek, you know, I mean, it's such a horrible fate. And the ugliest cast in film history, I mean...
It is, every one of them is ugly, especially and that David, you know, Brian's friend. What does he think he is, like young Columbo wearing that trench coat and smoking that stogie? I don't know.
Yeah, well, anyway... I guess we got to go on to a much finer film.
Yeah, I think this is our pick of the week.
Definitely. Pick of the month.
Pick of the month, yeah.
And of course, we're talking about Bad Taste.
This is smut.
No, it's not. It's spiritual.
And Peter Jackson, who is the writer, director, editor...
Producer,
actor, makeup effects guy in this film. He's really amazing. He's got a lot of talent. He was working at a newspaper while he was doing this movie. He was working 6 days a week, so he had to shoot the thing on Sundays, and they just dragged it out and shot it on Sundays and came up with this amazing movie. And the plot basically is real simple. The The Astro Investigation Defense Service, excuse me, that one's hard to say, is called out to investigate a possible alien invasion in a small town in New Zealand. And these aliens basically are chopping up humans to take back to their home planet for a gourmet delight.
Which isn't, you know, a real new idea in science fiction. You know, it's in the Twilight Zone with Disturbed Man, we had a series V, but it's done so well here. This film is just, it's exciting, it's got a lot of action, it's a real...
Well, the camera work is really amazing, too. It's none of this locked down crap that you get in a lot of stuff. It's...
Well, like just, Dr. Minx, where it was all medium shots the whole way through, we didn't get any close-ups of her, really, they'd be in bed, and we possibly get to see some Hooters, but they'd give us a medium shot so we can...
Yeah, and what I like about it is the fact that the camera is just constantly moving.
There's some great camera work, and I think this shows that, you know, this is a low-budget film, but just because you're low-budget doesn't mean you have to leave your camera stationary. I mean, you know, a moving camera doesn't cost any more money than just leaving it on a tripod.
Well, the editing and stuff is really great in this movie, too. There's some scenes that we're going to be showing here in mere moments where you'll see what we're talking about, and in fact, we might as well get down to that.
Yeah, whenever we stop bantering. check out this camera work on this first clip.
The headshot's the only true stopper.
You're wondering why you're soaking in Reggie's 11 secret herbs and spices. Tomorrow we're having you for lunch. Get him, Barry.
For God's sake, guys, keep it quiet.
Shut up, boys.
I just cleaned it, but... Oh, that's gross.
Gee, they come to bits easy.
Picked up by the Beatles.
This is great stuff.
I know, man. This film is wonderful. I'm really glad you showed it to me the first time I saw it. And God, it's a great film.
Yeah, I've been trying to turn everybody onto it. You know, it's just too cool to pass up. It's easy to spot the box because it's an alien throwing a finger. It's one to look for.
Yeah, I think this is another one of those films that's just coming out of New Zealand is actually where this was made, and there's a lot of talent coming out of it. This Quiet Earth, which we might talk about sometime, I think there's a lot of talent there that we haven't seen yet. One thing we wanted to both say is this film does have a lot of gore, but even if you know the kind of person, I don't like gore, I can't watch that, we still urge you to watch this
weenie
film.
If you're like that, by the way.
Yeah. Here, weenie, but even if you're that way, we urge you, go out and see this film, because First of all, the violence is kind of cartoony. The gore is, I mean, the gore is real cartoony. The blood colors are very vibrant. They're, you know, they're not realistic.
That's like
blood
Dawn
colors.
Of the Dead. The blood's kind of, you know.
It's a bright red. I mean, boy, it's bright. And then as you saw there in our clips too, you know, there's even some Monty Python kind of humor with the sheep getting blown up. So just go see this film.
I would
film.
Definitely say that this movie gets my highest recommendation of all the stuff we've reviewed so far.
I think so. It's just rent it. Buy it. Even buy it, you know.
Yeah, buy it.
Buy it so he'll get more, so Peter Jackson will get more royalties and come out with some more great stuff.
Definitely.
Transition.
Okay, kids, once again, it's time for the exercise portion of our show. Let's all get down and twist and shout with Tracy Lawrence.
Transition.
Tougher Than Leather. It's sort of a modern-day blaxploitation epic starring Run DMC, of all people. Well, it's kind of weird. Craig had a problem with it because he is not a rap music fan for the most part.
I like some of the music in it.
Well, yeah.
I like the party scene music.
But it was also his first blaxploitation film experience, and I've seen a few more of them.
I don't like the way that sounds.
I got a fairly high tolerance for rap music, so I could sit through the thing with no problem. If you don't like rap music, I would recommend passing this one up and renting Bucktown or something. But and also, Bucktown is probably much more entertaining as blaxploiters go. It's got Fred Williamson, of course, and you know he's the king of men, so it's definitely worth checking that one out. But anyway, Tougher Than Leather, the whole deal with it is it's actually directed by Rick Rubin, who has produced albums for all these guys, and he plays the evil mafioso son in it, who runs this record company that's basically set up to launder money. And the whole deal is he signs Run DMC and the Beastie Boys, who appear in a weird little scene where they're slipping in beer and then trying to pick up on girls. Anyway, he signs them to a contract, sends them on tour, and they have their little cheeseburger fetcher, Runny Ray, with them, who actually accidentally stumbles onto a killing that Rick Rubin is committing to wipe out a guy who's had his hand in his pocket, as it were. And Runny Ray gets gunned down, and it's made to look like a crack killing. And Run DMC, you know, of course, just hates that dang crack stuff, so they pack up some guns and go looking for Whitey, and
I think we should get into those clips.
I think so.
But I don't gotta worry, cause I'm so damn cold. Cold, cold rockin'. My name is Adam Yaga, and I know you're all rockin'.
We're just showing this scene so you can see Ad Rock get shot down.
All right, baby. I'd rather just stay out here with you anyway.
Yeah, lucky me.
So yeah. How'd you like to go out with a handsome, sexy, charming hunk tonight, huh?
Why? You got a friend?
You're doing a good job of hiding it, you know? But I can tell that you wanted me from the minute I walked through that door.
Is he for real?
How could you turn down dinner and dancing with me?
Did he tell you about his rash?
In what was described by police as a crack deal gone wrong, two youths shot and killed each other at a Run DMC concert. What made the incident even more suspicious was that both of the murdered youths were employed by the group. authorities point to this incident as the strongest example yet of the relationship between rap music, crack, and violence.
Guess they can't, read the sign.
That means no spooks.
I don't see no spooks around here. You see any spooks around here, Jay?
Nah, man, I ain't seen no spooks since Halloween.
So how about our homeboy?
Look, you boys better scram before somebody gets hurt.
I ain't finished my beer yet.
Well, here you go. One nigga special. Now drink your drink and get the fuck out of here. I said drink it. All I have to do is I can't believe. Well, I'll bet you I'm a gun in the storm. I will lost if you came. Hello, baby, I'm next door. Cause I could play the part.
Now, you don't want to do that. After all, you said you didn't want any trouble, remember?
I'm gonna step. Hold up, man, I always wanted to do this.
The piggy victim in this scene is played by Vic Noto, the crazed Vietnam vet from Street Trash.
Man, don't hurt me.
Hold on, let me ask you something. What the fuck was you gonna do to us?
Bernie, he paid us $100 each, man, to take care of anybody who was looking for him. I ain't lying, brother. I ain't lying.
Where's he at now?
I don't know.
Relax, relax, man. We just gonna play a little game. You ever played this little piggy before?
Huh?
Well, let me show you how it's played. Where's Bernie at?
I don't know, man. I don't know.
Then this little piggy went to the market.
Ah!
Where's Bernie at?
I don't know, man. Jesus Christ.
This
I don't know.
He stayed home.
Ah! Ah!
Ah! Where's he at?
I don't know. I don't know where he is.
This little piggy had roast beef.
Ah! Ah!
Ah! Where's Bernie at?
Ah! All right, man. No more. No more piggies. I'll talk. The LaSalle Hotel, man. That's where Bernie is. I'm not lying, brother. I ain't lying.
Where it's at.
Now, if I was you, I'd crawl up under the boxes and get my fingers fixed.
This little piggy cried wee, wee, wee all the way home. This was always my favorite little piggy.
Later, the boys track down Rick Rubin's Sleaze, played by ex-Pong Queen and Fabulous Blade, Lois Ayers.
Yeah, I'm gonna check it out.
What's this about?
A new raid.
I do nothing.
Let me tell you something. You gonna tell everybody who killed Jerry and Runny Ray? You hear me? We just gonna find another dead spaghetti headed in the East River. Go get the car, Jay.
Badger, you make me sick!
You can either live or die. Your choice.
Why don't you give me a chance to go for my gun and we see who dies?
You ain't gotta be that way, man. All I want you to do is come tell how my man Ray got shot.
Can't do that now, man. I come too far. Why don't you give a brother a fair chance?
Fair what? You don't wanna tell me this ain't no game.
And I was right.
A black man that wants big money ain't got a choice on how he makes it.
A man always has a choice.
Okay, it was an entertaining flick, as blaxploiters go, and you know, I mean, you just don't see those kind of movies anymore. But I can't help but feel it would be a cooler movie if, you know, Public Enemy had been in instead of Run.
Well, I think one of your reactions, and I remember when we were actually watching this film, was that you thought that if there had been less rap and more action, it'd be better too.
It kind of comes off like they thought they could make a movie and a few music videos at the same time.
Yeah, that's it. It's not, you know, we're not saying the rap sucks here. We're just saying that if you're going to do a black exploitation movie like that, it should be more solid action.
Yeah, well, you know, you got to admit, though, that Run DMC pulled it off well. I mean, Jam Master Jay, especially, I think, turned into fun.
Yeah, they weren't bad. They weren't bad.
And, you know, it had a cool cast. I mean, you know, Run DMC were cool. And Richard Edson from Do the Right Thing and Stranger Than Paradise. And
yeah, that's right.
That kind of stuff. And Lois Ayres, of course.
Oh,
ex-porno queen and fabulous babe extraordinaire.
Yeah, she looked mighty fine. I don't think she should have been in the movie more. I think we should have been introduced to her character more.
I would have gladly been introduced to her character earlier.
You know, personal opinion.
But
I think one of the strange things about this is that, of course, there was some actual violence at some Run DMC concerts, and so they were one of the first rappers to come out and tell their fans, "Hey, you know, it's just a concert. Let's all get together and enjoy the music. Let's not be beating each other up or knifing each other." And then they turn around and do this movie in which they, you know, there's lots of gunplay.
Beat up a lot of guys and shoot people all over the place and throw grenades into cars. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, it's definitely, I would recommend it. If you're a fan of blaxploitation epics at all, it's definitely worth checking out, even just as a curiosity. It's, like I said, not as cool as Fred Williamson's classic stuff, but...
Well, one of the other things was that Spike Lee was actually approached to make it.
Yeah, that's interesting. He was approached to direct it, and then they ended up getting Rick Rubin, who, you know, had never directed anything before. But he pulled it off well. I mean, you know, there's some static angles and stuff in it, but it's still, it comes off pretty well.
Yeah.
It doesn't look anywhere near as bad as, you know, Dr. Minx, so...
Well, I think we were just disappointing Dr. Minx all around.
Definitely. I was hoping for a laugh ride with lots of, you know, nudity, but, and, you know, Big Bill. But anyway, I guess that's about it for the movies on another installment of Cheez Flikz.
And we're hoping next time, this was kind of a disappointment ending up in the basement, but we're hoping because they used so little money to build this set that we'll be able to go to Eastern Europe for our next show.
This will be great. We're going to try and seek out some Eastern European Cheez Flikz while we're there.
And Eastern European babes, if we can find them. They might all be hiding in buildings, and, you know, some, there's shooting going on in some of this country still.
Anyway, since we are on this new set, we'd like to extend an offer, and if you would like to send us something to paste up on the wall or set on our little filth-covered table or throw on the floor, drop us a line, send us what you got, you know, let us know what you think of the show, if you even watch the show.
And especially if there's any movies that you think are cheese flick classics that we should be talking about. Well, the address is on those credits.
Beer can. And I guess...
Yeah, I think the main thing is, video store owners, send us your posters.
Definitely.
And,
I think that about does it for this installment of Cheez
Flikz. I think so. Until next time, goodbye from our new set.
Keep it turgid.